Morning to everyone. Today I have with me in our series, Let Us Be Honest series, where we interview prominent people, lawyers, doctors, journalists from different ethnic groups about this subject of misinformation, disinformation, also about violent extremism and hate speech. So I have with me today, and I would say I'm privileged to have with me today, Maaz Yusuf. He has a Bachelor of Law Honours degree from the University of London. He's an attorney of law of the Supreme Court, and also happens to be the former legal and corporate advisor to UAE Presidential Private Department. I'm sure you have a lot of experience and a lot of things to share today. Also, he's an author, he's a lecturer, editor, a rule of law advocate. And if you go through Daily FT, that Daily Financial Times, you will see his columns. So he writes very regularly on social issues, issues relating to ethnic harmony and all that. So Maaz, can I call you Maaz?
Right? Yes, please. Yeah. Good morning to you, Amar.
Yeah, yes, Maaz. Now, I'm going to ask you some hard questions. It is not necessarily, I must explain to you, it is not my view, neither it is the view of Maaz Institute, but these are views of people, you know, constantly bombarding our social media. So I'll go straight to the first question. You know, we all agree that, you know, that, because of the Easter bombings, what happened, you know, the unfortunate thing that happened. All eyes are pointed at you, fingers are pointed at the Muslim community, saying, you know, there is violent extremism within the Muslim community. But you as moderates, what are you all doing? Why are you silent? Why can't you attend to this? So this is my first hot seat question. How would you respond to that?
Thank you, Amar, for having me in your program. Appreciate it very much, and also appreciate the time and the effort dedicated by you all towards coexistence and ethnic harmony in our country. Very, very commendable. Let me get to your question. Basically, I think we should not divide the community as moderate or extremist Muslims. In my view, I think we must look at this as a national issue.
Exactly.
And we have to collectively address it. Right. Of course, with the help of the Muslim communities and all other stakeholders. Now, let us analyze this a little. The question, in fact, will become a question, the validity of the question itself, because it takes for granted that extremism is endemic among the Muslims, which is not true. A few Muslims does not make the whole of the Muslim community. For example, during the JVP insurrections, in 1971 and 1989, no one divided the Sinhala community as extremists and moderate.
Quite correct, yes.
We all got together and addressed the issue as a collective, single nation. Besides that, what is extremism? It's a very, very relative term. Where does extremism begin and where does it end? Moreover, extremism is a very, very fashionable word to target Islam and Muslims, not only in Sri Lanka, worldwide, all over the world.
Yes.
Now, let us take, for example, Anagarika Dharmapala. He was a proponent of this Sinhala Buddhist community. And he went to the extent of saying that all non-Sinhala Buddhists living in Sri Lanka are parayas. And only the Sinhala Buddhists have the right to claim for Sri Lanka. This thing has been brought forward by the famous Victor Ivan in one of his articles to the Daily FT.
Yes.
On 26th February. In fact, I'm quoting Victor Ivan. Mm. Now, Victor Ivan says that this cancer of Anagarika Dharmapala continued even in the post-independence era. That is the era that we are living today.
Mm.
Now, for some of the Sinhala Buddhists, Anagarika Dharmapala is considered as a revivalist.
Of course.
As a reformist.
Yeah.
But then, right-minded, rational thinking, logical thinking people, whether it is Sinhala or non-Sinhala, may call him or his views as extremist views. So we have...
I'm not too conversant about this. I've heard this before. In fact, I have this conversation.
I'm quoting Victor Ivan, in fact.
Yeah, I had this conversation with Victor also because I was involved with his Punarudya program sometime
ago.
Yes,
yes, correct, correct, correct. And then we come to what is moderate Muslim or what is a moderate Buddhist or moderate Christian? Where does it begin and where does it end?
Exactly.
And if we speak about moderation in religion, has any religion demarcated boundaries that this is the boundary where moderation ends and extremism begins? No. So it,
Master,
I think in short, that would be the answer. We have to collectively address this and cease calling these communities as extremists and moderates and all of those things.
Yeah. My next question is, I'll jump to the next question. You see,
yes.
Another accusation or another kind of allegation, I won't say use the word accusation, allegation is a proper word, is that Muslims pay a higher priority for their religion and also they want to kind of do not want to kind of connect with or we don't want to kind of recognize or respect other cultures. They pay higher priority to the religion and you know want to be separate, you know, in a sense. Do you agree with this particular point of view? Do you have your own point of view to give to that?
Yeah. Wonderful question, Amar. In fact, it's a very, very valuable question, and which is generally there. This is an absolute misunderstanding. I think this also needs to be analyzed. I thank you for raising that question.
Hmm.
Yeah. Now we have to understand the difference between identicalness and equalness.
Yeah.
Man and woman cannot be identical. Physiologically, biologically, they are different.
Yeah.
And then also we have to see the difference between a plural community and majority community.
Mm.
We also need to understand the difference between majority culture and minority culture. Mm.
Right.
Now, what happens is we mix up all these things without proper understanding.
Mm.
And we ourselves are in a state of confusion.
Correct. Correct.
So we come up with very illogical and irrational types of questioning that the Muslims want to have their own culture. They don't coexist with other cultures and all of these things. Coexistence in a plural society, sociologically, is predicated by understanding, tolerance, accommodation and appreciation of the limits of the others.
Exactly. I think you brought out an interesting point. Now, when talking to young people and they bring this up, I always ask them, you know, why don't you learn something positive from other cultures, other ethnic groups?
Exactly. You
know, sometimes they say, oh, these people are making a lot of money. So learn a trade, learn how they are doing business. Why can't
Correct.
We also learn from them? And, you know, because I think a lot of these feelings are due to insecurities, and sometimes it is due to jealousy. Pure, plain and simple. We try to gloss over that and try to bring out other points and all, fear, this, that, the other. But at the end of the day, I think there is jealousy among us Sri Lankans. You know, there are a lot of stories, you know, about how, you know, in hell, there is no God at the place where Sri Lankans are, because the devil says, no, they don't try to escape. When somebody tries to escape, somebody else tries to pull them down.
Yeah, I heard that story.
Right? So I think we need to get out of this, at least in the 21st century, even with COVID coming and hitting us, and it has brought sometimes communities together, neighbors together. I think it's a good lesson for us to see, after we get out of the COVID or whatever, whether we can coexist and live together. Anyway,
correct.
Thank you very much.
If you permit me, Aman, a slight highlight on that in my answer is that you see, cultural diversity necessarily demands incompatible sets of values. That is where the diversity comes. Because if all the sets of cultural values are the same, there is no diversity there.
Of course, yeah.
And that is what we find in Sri Lanka. And actually, as Sri Lankans must be very proud of that. We have cultural diversity.
And it's so beautiful, you know, that our country is beautiful because of this diversity. Not just physical diversity, but also diversity in people, diversity in beliefs, diversity in value sets. But, you know, which you know, falls in line with the basic human values, you know.
Exactly.
So my last question is a kind of you might laugh at my face when I ask this question. Is a bit of a ridiculous question because I know the answer to this, but I like a response from you, and I'm very interested to ask how you respond to this question. You know, there is again allegation saying Muslims want to live by different rules, probably because of some politician statements of few politicians, you know, but we can't generalize this. And the general statement is that Muslims don't purchase things from secular shops, right? So I'm not going to come and give my view on this, right?
Yes.
I'm not going to say what I think, but I like your kind of response to this question.
You are very realistic, Amar, I should say that. But these are questions, you know, that's always spoken about. Now, in fact, I can divide this question into two areas. One is the Muslims wanting to live by different rules. And the second, that Muslims, you know, do not want to patronize non-Muslim entities, shops or whatever.
Yeah.
So I'll have these, I have sort of divided it into two, and let me answer the first one. With regard to the different rules, that Muslims want different rules, this is again a gross misunderstanding in fact. Now, each religion and each culture has its own set of rules. And one has to respect that. I mean, Buddhism has its own set of rules. Christianity has its own set of rules. Similarly, Islam and Hinduism has, you know, its own sets of rules. There cannot be a mixture of these rules with a dominant culture or a dominant religion. So these are things that has to be respected. And in fact, international norms, international conventions respect these things.
Of course.
Now, speaking about different rules and Muslim want to live with different rules, it is again an incorrect statement. Now, for example, we'll take the Mahapoya Day. Now, the Mahapoya Day is a day when those who would like to have a drink are deprived of their liberty and freedom to have a drink on that day.
Okay.
You see? So, and those who like to eat meat on that day, along with a drink, for example, cannot do that. So,
the thing is, you can buy the drink the day before or buy the meat the day before.
That's, That happens. That happens. You will find a long queue near the white stores just before the evening of the day before Mahapoya Day.
Yeah.
So now these are rules related to the Buddhist philosophy. And government departments are closed on that day. So a non-Buddhist who wants to get something done through the government department is unable to do it because the government departments are closed. Now, for example, Muslims are not accusing or making a big fuss against the Buddhists saying that you are having different rules. No, these are things that has to be respected. Now, if the Buddhists say that Poya Day has to be a day like this, then whether it is Muslims or Christians or Hindus, all of them must respect that view. And that similar respect must come from that side also towards the Christians, yes, the Muslims, and the Buddhists in whatever their culture and religion states. So therefore, this thought of different rules is in fact a very logical one. Now let us take, for example, food practices. Now this is a very common thing, this halal, haram, and all of those things. Now, what is halal is something that is permitted in Islam. Haram is something that is prohibited in Islam. And these two, permission and the prohibition, are made not blindly, but with scientific basis. Now let us take pork. Pork is prohibited for Muslims. And why is it prohibited for Muslims? Because it has a lot of parasitic roundworms and it causes a lot of diseases. In fact, hepatitis E, which affects the liver of a person, is partly because of consumption of pork. And then there is what is called trichinosis or whatever, which infects the intestines of a human being. Now, for these scientific reasons, I'm just giving you examples. For these scientific reasons, pork is considered something that should not be consumed by human beings. Mm-hmm. So Muslims are told, you don't consume it.
Yeah.
Well, what is not good for Muslims is not good for other human beings also.
Of course, yes.
Now, if
or even Jews don't consume
exactly. Pork. If pork eating will cause problems in the liver for a Muslim, definitely it will cause liver a problem for a non-Muslim also.
Yes.
So there is no big issue that, you know, halal and haram. In fact, it is good to follow the halal even by the non-Muslims because it is something good that is told in the consumption of food. Now, if you take that and say that Muslims want different rules, then it sounds very, very illogical.
Yes.
Now, let's come to the other question.
Other question.
About buying food or whatever stuff from, you know, not buying actually.
Yeah.
In fact, the contrary is the truth. That is, it is the Sinhalese, some of the Sinhalese people who are sort of, if I use the word, who,
extreme or racist.
Extreme or whatever, yeah. They are the people who have been saying boycott Muslim shops.
Of course. Yeah.
Because there is nothing called Muslim rice or Muslim vegetable, no? Now, if I go to the shop, I will take vegetables that is grown by an Apuami or Somapala or some farmer.
Mm-hmm.
There is no Muslim vegetable or Muslim rice. So these are all irrational things, you know. So when we go and buy rice, we go and buy rice. And we know definitely there are a lot of Sinhala farmers who are helping us with that produce. We are thankful to them. We are grateful to them because we can go to the shop and buy it and we can satisfy our hunger. So there is no issue of Muslims not going to that shop or this shop. Of course, if it is meat,
yeah,
then definitely Muslims prefer to go to a Muslim shop and buy the meat because there is a process of slaughter.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. It is only for that purpose. But if it is fish, we go and buy. Now I go and buy my fish from my Sinhala fisherman. There is no issue. I'm not buying Muslim fish. This is again a misunderstanding. Yes.
Mas, we have come to the end of our time for our discussion, but I want to ask another question. I want to ask your suggestions, actually. If you can suggest something just from your personal experience, suggest what can MARGA do as a research organization, as a civil society organization to, I mean, we are doing several things, but I like to get your opinion, a fresh opinion. What can we do to, counter this misinformation and also disinformation to a certain, malicious lies that are kind of propagated that causes a break of trust between communities? Is there anything, apart from, you are doing a tremendous job writing, constantly writing to the papers and putting out blog articles, stuff like that. But at the ground level, at the grassroots level, is there anything that you can suggest that we could do, we as Sri Lankans should do to bring out greater understanding and more harmony within communities?
This MAGA Institute is an institute where intellectuals interact.
Yes, and
So there are two ways you can do this, in my view. One is because you have intellectual interaction, these ideas will have to be deliberated, discussed, and understood among the intellects, because it is from that level that it pervades downwards to the lower sections. Now, for example, if we speak of university lecturers, if the university lecturers are taught or given the correct understanding of things, then that would help them to spread that idea of proper understanding to their students. And their students tomorrow are going to be the bureaucrats. So when they occupy the seat of bureaucracy tomorrow, then they are occupying that seat with a proper understanding of all these different values in a plural society. So MAGA Institute, from that point of view, from intellectual point of view, I think should do more work amongst the intellectuals, because I am going on the basis of a top-bottom approach.
Actually, you get organizations like Center for Policy Alternatives, Lionel Gurudev is working with university students. Then you have, Center for Equality and Justice, they are working with women at the community level. Then there is, they are engaged with these organizations. Then you have Center for Investigative Journalism. They are working with journalists. And Sarvodaya is working on a ground level with communities. So a lot of work has been done, my personal approach is to see what has been done and how MARGA can complement those organizations without us trying to, scramble for donor funding and do a project and forget about it. You see, countering hate speech is a generational project. We'll have to do this, and our children will not have to pass it on. And maybe, so I'm also thinking of what can we do with organizations like Helvitas, with Learn Asia. They are all working on this area. So I think we all have to pool our resources, and MARGA can be a platform, can be a place where y'all can come anytime, our facilities are open, our auditorium is open. If you want to have a discussion with a group, you just give me a call and say, look, can
thank
we?
Thank you very much. Yeah. Very kind.
So I think we need to do this because this is very important. Our future is at stake. And
of course,
we are trying to build our tourism industry. Who would want to come to Sri Lanka, Mas, if their people are fighting? Nobody wants to go to house where there is bickering and fighting, So, anyway, I think I will take up your suggestion. We'll see how we could engage with university lecturers, heads of research organizations, you know, people, intellectuals who are influencing people, who have
exactly
who have the capacity to influence and who has
correct
the,
you know, correct
vision and will to influence. Yes.
In fact, what Maga must do is become opinion creating leader.
Yeah.
That is what Maga should be doing. And of course, Maga is doing a lot of work. I mean, it's a very, very old institution and well-established institution.
Yeah, we are going in for our 50th anniversary next year.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, you have to be sort of opinion creators, you know, opinion-making leaders.
Anyway, thank you so much for your time. I really, really appreciate your time that you spent with me, giving your honest opinion. This program is all about let us be honest. And
yes.
I think people who listen to you or who will listen in the future as I put this recording on our social media platforms, I think they will have plenty of food for thought. And my hope and my prayer is that somewhere, somehow or other, we can change the thinking of young people.
Absolutely.
We can achieve.
Absolutely.
So thank you very much, Mas.
Thank you.
Wish you all the best and have a great day and stay safe.
Thank you.